All right, so I want to welcome everybody to our Grand Rounds presentation for today. For those of you who are new, or just as a reminder, you are able to request presentations or specific presenters. If you go to our website, there is a form you can fill out, or you're more than welcome to email myself or Dr. Cruz if you have ideas of topics or presenters that you would like to see. And so today, for the Family Medicine Grand Rounds, today is July 13th, and our event code for today is 13047. You can access through your phone, or you can do the browser, and you'll want to make sure that you register for your credit if you're wanting CME credit before midnight today. Would like to thank y'all in advance for muting your microphone once our presentation begins, also being attentive to our presenter, being engaged in the session, and then of course completing and submitting a session evaluation form, which I'll put that information in the chat box towards the end of the presentation. And so this is a South Texas Regional Family Medicine Grand Rounds, along with our educational partner, the South Central AHEC. And we are serving our department's mission by inventing a healthier future for families and communities in San Antonio, South Texas, and beyond through excellence in patient-centered care, research, and education. If you are interested in viewing your CME transcript, you just go to the CME website. The address is there, and you can log in and you can see your specific transcript. Also, if you are interested in AAFP, please be sure to go to the website and just let me know if you have any questions. So Dr. Jayashah has no relevant financial interest with commercial interest to disclose. And today he's gonna be giving us an update in diabetic foot ulcer management. So I will let Dr. Shaw take it away.
Oh, thank you, Rubio. Thank you, Nicole. Thank you for that introduction. All right, so I am a private practice physician. I do wound care and hyperbaric medicine in South San Antonio and North San Antonio to multiple hospitals here. And I'll try to share my experience with diabetic wound management today and discuss some of the staggering statistics and also understand the role of hyperbaric oxygen therapy. And my important goal today is to really see how we can really evaluate a diabetic foot ulcer patient and really come up with a good standard wound management plan so that it can be useful to all family practice physicians who are listening to this presentation today. So I'm going to start by talking about a case so that we can understand and put it in perspective that let's look at this typical 65-year-old diabetic male that we all see gets admitted with infected diabetic gangrene. He's, you know, young guy, he's 52-year-old, he works in a factory, he wears the steel toe boots, and he started wound 30 days ago. He didn't pay attention to it, and it got really worse. It started smelling. So his wife said, you know, I need to send you to a wound clinic. I need to send you to your doctor. And that's how this patient ended up coming to us. By the time this patient came to us, as you see, his foot is infected. It's gangrenous. You see there is a purulent drainage coming out. And this patient is in trouble, right? When he came to us, as you see that when you examine this patient carefully, and if you look at this picture, you'll find that this patient has head loss, there is cyanosis, and there is onychomycosis changes, and the toe is completely gangrenous, as you see in this picture. So this patient, when he comes to us, you know what this patient is afraid of? This diabetic patient is more fearful of amputation than death. And that's been in the statistics. If they look, this study showed when they looked at the diabetic patient and they asked them, you know, what are you afraid of when you have a diabetic foot ulcer? And these patients are more afraid of amputation than even death. They just really feel that their life is going to be miserable if they lose that lower extremity or end up getting amputation. Do you know if Mr. R a patient that you typically see in the hospital get admitted with this infected gangrene, you know how long this patient will survive? What are his chances at 5 years? It's pretty staggering statistics. You know, every 20 seconds, a leg is lost to diabetes somewhere in the world. And patients like Mr. RG, if you really look at this data, and there is a very good article, there's a review article by Dr. Armstrong on New England Journal of Medicine that I would like you all you to review. But the 5-year mortality of patients with diabetic wound is more than 50%. And it is basically, if they have an ulcer, their kind of mortality rate goes up by 2.5 times. And they are, you know, if you really look at the mortality rate of a patients with diabetic foot ulcer, that's more than prostate cancer, breast cancer, and Hodgkin's lymphoma combined. So it's a pretty staggering statistic. Like patients with diabetic foot ulcer has a very, very high mortality, and we need to really learn how to manage them so that we can decrease their mortality, help them heal their wounds quickly. And you know, their mortality starts clicking as soon as they start getting amputation. Once they get amputation, within first 30 days, they have 11% chance of dying. First 90 days, they have 18% chance of dying. And if you really look at further, by 5 years, they have a chance of around 68% after amputation. And if you are on dialysis, then it makes it even worse. One in every two patients will die next year after amputation if they are on dialysis. This is a pretty big JAMA study. This is on a registry of more than 3 million patients. And they found that every second patient will die after major amputation. This is really staggering statistics. And if they look at this bigger picture, diabetic foot ulcer study from the VA, where they really looked at more than 66,000 patients, they found that initial diabetic ulcer severity is more significant predictor of subsequent mortality than coronary artery disease, peripheral vascular disease, or stroke. This is something very significant. And if you really look at the WHO, you know, related lower extremity complication and leading cause of global disability, diabetic ulcer has just reached within the first 10 reasons why someone will have global burden of disability. So this is a significant disease. So what Mr. RG is on a patient like Mr. RG comes to you, you need to understand that these patients really require a lot of attention and care, because if once they get amputation, their mortality is pretty high. Let's look at some of the epidemiological disparities between the border town and a non-border town, and what is the disparity between the races. So this person is Hispanic male. Let's look at and see if Hispanics or Black has a higher cause of problems, and if this patient presents in a border town of Texas, will he have a different outcome than patient presenting in a big a metropolitan city or somewhere which is non-border town? And they found that border town, when they compared the data between border town and a non-border town, the patients who are in the border town has much higher risk of mortality, you know, much higher risk of mortality and much higher chances of that patient getting amputation. And also when they compared with the different races, they found that, you know, Black Americans and African American and Hispanic has much higher risk of amputation compared to whites. And the same way, they when they have second amputation, when they looked at it, they found that African American and Hispanics have a much higher rates of second amputation. So there is a huge racial disparities. There is a huge disparities between a border and a non-border town. So when you look and assess a patient like Mr. RG that we talked about on an initial slide, what are the predictors of healing in this patient? And if you really look at the study, you will find that the predictors of healing differ in a patient with or without peripheral vascular disease. That someone, you know, it looks like if patient has a diabetes and peripheral vascular disease, those have two different outcomes than patient who has diabetes and no peripheral vascular disease. But the most important independent healing predictors they found in this study was older age, male sex, heart failure, inability to stand or walk without help, end-stage renal disease, large ulcer size, peripheral neuropathy, and peripheral arterial disease. So that's what they found. Okay, so again, as you see in this study, they found that once they have peripheral vascular disease and infection, those patients have much higher risk of amputation. Like Mr. RG, he has infection, he has peripheral vascular disease, and he has a gangrene. That really changes the game here. This patient is at much higher risk of amputation. Diabetic foot ulcers are costly, and we need to understand that average cost of treating a diabetic ulcer is between $5,000 to $25,000. Okay, once they have an ulcer, they have a much higher cost. And once if you really look at it, their cost continues to increase after the ulcer episode by 4.4 times. Okay, and once they have amputation, their cost is even higher, about $45,000. So again, if you really look at the estimate of the cost in 2007, the treatment of diabetes and its complication costed around $116 billion. And 33% were linked to the treatment of foot ulcer. And if you really look at this article, you'll find that the inpatient stay accounted for 73% of the increased cost compared with the non-diabetic. So again, once they get inpatient, once they get infected, once they have gangrene, their cost is much higher. So in summary, if you look at this American Diabetic Association article, and where they look at the cost and outcome in a 6.7 million ambulatory care diabetic patients, they found that approximately 50% of the diabetic foot ulcers get infected. 20% of them will get some level of amputation. They found that diabetic foot ulcers are common, complex, and costly. And they're more common and deadly than congestive heart failure, MI, or stroke. Patients with diabetic foot ulcers have increased risk of emergency room visits and inpatient admission. Just remember, it's a costly disease. So we all need to learn how to take care of them properly, how to prevent emergency, how can you prevent ulceration. We all need to learn if you want to make a dent in the cost of taking care of this diabetic foot ulcer patients. So how do we evaluate a diabetic foot ulcer patient? It's extremely important for a family physician to understand how to evaluate a diabetic foot ulcer patient. It's important that while we are managing the chronic disease, while we are managing the diabetes patient, we understand the complications of diabetes, understand that we need to be screening for vascular assessment when that patient comes for your diabetes check, and look for the pulse, look for and palpate dorsal ispides or posterior stibialis pulse. And that's the minimum vascular exam you can do. You can look at the foot. Is it cold? You can look at a capillary refill, see if it is less than 3 seconds or greater than 3 seconds. If they have an ulcer, you can send to the specialized wound center to check for transcutaneous oxygen studies. You want to also check for neuropathy exam, which should be part of the physical when you do a family practice exam on a diabetic patient, and do a 5.07 monofilament testing, which is around 10 grams of pressure, but that is the limit for protective sensation. You want to check for foot deformity and make sure that the foot is intact. And if they have a callus, you should be able to help with the callus trimming and checking their toenails if they are getting a fungal infection. If they have an ulcer, you want to look at what the grading is, and we'll go over there, what's the size is, what's the drainage, if there is an infection or not. We should be able to assess that minimal thing in our clinics. And you can grade that ulcer depending on how deep that ulcer is. You know, if you are having up to subcutaneous tissue, that's grade one. But if you start getting bone or tendon exposed, then it becomes grade two. And once it gets infected and osteomyelitis, tendonitis, or deep abscess, it's grade three. And then if you have a gangrene like Mr. RG, that's considered Wagner grade four diabetic foot ulcer. Now, I have the comparison between Wagner grading and a pressure ulcer and venous and arterial. This is from textbook of chronic wound care that we wrote, and that you can compare and you can make sure that they are not the same. So don't get confused between Wagner grading of a diabetic foot ulcer with a pressure ulcer. Now, let's understand what are the basic tenets of diabetic wound care in this patient like Mr. RG. And if you look at the CMS criteria of when hyperbaric oxygen therapy or any advanced wound care will be approved in a diabetic foot ulcer, they pretty much delineate that what is the standard care that you should provide with a diabetic foot ulcer before you even consider advanced wound treatment or hyperbaric oxygen therapy. And they write down clearly that every patient should be looked for vascular issues. And if there is a vascular problem, it should be corrected. Every patient should have a nutritional assessment. Every patient should be optimized with their diabetes glucose control. They should be make sure if they have a diabetic ulcer, they're getting debridement. They're getting wound which is cleaned and has a moist dressing. They're appropriately offloaded, and you're treating necessary infection. So understanding that this is kind of a standard care before you even jump into a hyperbaric oxygen therapy or any advanced treatment. So any diabetic ulcer patient, you need to make sure you're managing their diabetes, you're managing their peripheral vascular disease, you're addressing the patient-centered concerns. So what we find that here in South Texas, you'll find that a lot of times patients with diabetes get amputation because these patients have trouble finding trouble coming to the doctor's office. They have a lot of social determinants of health that causes amputation. So again, you want to address that. And then when you're addressing the local wound care, the five main principles that I teach for wound care is mainly debridement, infection control, moisture balance, edge effect, and correction of hypoxia. And we'll try to look at them as we go along. Understanding the nutrition management is extremely important when a diabetic wound ulcer patient or any ulcer wound patient, and understanding to check their nutritional markers, if they are at risk, and checking if their albumin is greater than 3.5, pre-albumin is greater than 20 gram per day, pre-albumin is greater than 20. Calorie, you want to make sure it's 35 to 60 kilocalorie per kg per body weight is sometimes needed. Protein, 1.2 to 1.5 gram. If it's a renal patient, then you want to be balancing that. Again, vitamin, I usually give them L-arginine, and I will give them vitamin C and zinc. But then if they have, I also check for vitamin D deficiency. And then if they have vitamin D deficiency, I'll give them vitamin D. Again, if they have anemia, iron is going to be a good thing to give if they have iron deficiency anemia. So you want to check for thoroughly for their nutrition. There's a data on zinc, which is a recent data that I would like to share, where there was a randomized trial and they looked at zinc in a diabetic foot ulcer patient, and they found that zinc group helped even had a better A1C, they had a better HDL and decrease in highly reactive CRP and a better healing in this diabetic foot ulcer trial, the randomized trial. It was a small trial, 30 patients in each group, but again, an important trial for us to understand the role of zinc in a diabetic foot ulcer patient. So how does hyperbaric therapy work? So I'm going to spend some time on hyperbaric oxygen therapy and see if we can really look at that and see. So if you look at hyperbaric oxygen therapy, it basically is where you're putting the patients inside the chamber. There are two kinds of chamber. One is called monoplace chamber, where a single person goes in and you compress the chamber with 100% oxygen, or you have a multiplace chamber where you have a multiple patients in that chamber, and that patient is basically the chamber is compressed by air, but the patient is getting oxygen with the help of a mask, okay? And that's how they're getting, and then you are pressurizing them to higher atmosphere. So every time you basically look at, if you are at sea level, you have a 0.3 volume percent ml per dL, but when you put them under almost to 3 atmosphere, most diabetic foot ulcer patients, though, we will treat at 2 atmosphere level. Okay, and as you will see that their plasma now, you have that oxygen saturation curve, the hemoglobin binds with the oxygen, and then whatever is left is goes in the plasma, and that oxygen is kind of readily available for your hypoxic wound, and that is helps your wound to heal when this oxygen is readily available for them. Okay, and as you see, under hyperbaric environment, the oxygen amount can go up to 6.80 volume percent. Okay, and that can dissolve oxygen can be easily available for that patients to help you with the healing. There are multiple mechanisms. This hyperbaric oxygen therapy is an old treatment. It's been around for more than 150 years. The most of the studies that you will find and the mechanism, the studies that you will find the older data that has helped you with infection control, helps the WBC to help to kill the infection. It will help you to decrease the bubble size. It will help you to correct the hypoxia. So there are many mechanisms that has been proven where hyperbaric oxygen therapy will be useful. The recent data from Dr. Tom found that it can increase the stem cell mobilization, and that is probably the mechanism why diabetic foot ulcer patients do well. He also found that there is an increased local stem cell engraftment and cell signaling growth responses. So again, that is an important mechanism that is helpful besides antibacterial, improved WBC bactericidal function, and impaired neutrophil beta 2 integrin addition. So again, that is something you may want to look at as other mechanisms why hyperbaric oxygen therapy is a useful thing. Now, what I'm going to focus on is what CMS or Medicare, most of the data shows that it's good for very severe diabetic foot ulcers, not for grade 1 and grade 2, the ones which are really at high risk for amputation, grade 3 and higher. And what's the data for that? And when we are talking about grade 3 and higher, we're talking about someone who has a full thickness infection with osteomyelitis, tendonitis, and deep abscess. So that's what you are basically looking at. Okay, so you're looking at this patient. This is a study which is a CPG guideline from our National Hyperbaric Organization, which is UHMS, which is Undersea and Hyperbaric Medical Society. And they published a data in 2015 where they did a grade analogy and they looked at all the data that's out there and try to see where does the hyperbaric oxygen therapy come in. And they ask a very simple questions that we all have, that what is there a data to treat a diabetic grade two ulcer. When we say grade two ulcer, it is someone who has a diabetic foot ulcer, which is probably up to tendon and bone, but it's not infected. So, or up to subcutaneous tissue. And the data showed that it's really not helpful for a grade two ulcer. On a grade two ulcer or a grade one diabetic ulcer, standard wound care alone is good enough. You don't need hyperbaric oxygen therapy to be used for Wagner grade two or grade one ulcer. But if it's a grade three, which is a deep ulcer with tendonitis, infection, osteomyelitis, or higher, or gangrene, then they found, yes, adding hyperbaric oxygen therapy, if that patient who has not healed for 30 days with standard wound management has the data of hyperbaric oxygen therapy doing better than control in this grade analysis. And that's what the CMS approves. CMS approves patient who has diabetic foot ulcer for more than 30 days, which has failed standard wound management and has already gone through vascular assessment that has been corrected, the glucose has been controlled, infection has been controlled, patient has got debridement and has done good standard wound management offloading. And in those scenario, hyperbaric oxygen therapy is a right next step to do to help them with the healing. They also asked the question, though the CMS guidelines quick shows that you can only use it in patients who have failed standard management for 30 days, but they looked at the data and looked at what happens for, what is the data for patient who has Wagner grade three or higher ulcer with infection, which has a progressive necrotizing infection or has gangrene or a deep space abscess after surgery, if we give hyperbaric oxygen therapy immediately, will they have a benefit? And they found in the data that yes, indeed, in the grade analysis, when they looked at all the studies, they found yes, that they did help in using patients' hyperbaric oxygen therapy right away when they have those severe infections. And rather, when they dissected the data of all the studies that has been done so far, and they found that yes, indeed, if hyperbaric oxygen therapy was given immediately, in most of the studies where they were given immediately, the major amputation decreased, okay? And the healing also helped. So again, giving immediately is a good idea, but right now insurance and most of this CMS data, right now CMS regulation doesn't allow you to use it immediately. So the data will support it if you want to use it immediately. All right, so Mr. RG got the peripheral palpable pulse. Shows hair pattern is absent hair up to middle of the leg. His ABIs are non-compressible. The arterial duplex studies does show monophasic flow. And TCOM shows severe hypoxia with no response to 100% oxygen. So this is our patient, RG, who presented to us with infected gangrene. So what is the data on TCOM? And if you really look at the data on TCOM, you'll find TCOM is a transcutaneous oxygen studies, where we put an electrode on the skin around the wound or around the foot to see whether patient has hypoxia or not and what is the perfusion at the skin level. And they found that ABI really, and they compared it with ABI in this article by Wang, and he found that ABI really performs poorly in predicting the healing of foot ulcer and modestly in predicting limb amputation, while transcutaneous oxygen studies does better job in doing both, predicting both the outcomes. So that is a pretty good test that if it's available, you should do it. Like Mr. RG, we did the TCOM and we found that he's extremely hypoxic. He's extremely hypoxic at the foot level. His oxygen number we are looking at for hypoxia is at least 40 in a diabetic patient, and he has numbers of 2 and 5. And as you see, we do an oxygen challenge and he doesn't respond, rather it goes down, which is basically tells us that he has a severe peripheral vascular disease which needs surgery. So if you do an angiogram, you find that this patient has, is like any typical diabetic patient, has a multi-vessel disease when they have atherosclerosis. And usually their disease is below the knee, like Mr. RG, their disease is below the knee and it goes in the foot level. As you see, it's only single runoff and the dorsal pedis kind of cuts off here and there's no perfusion below going towards the toe, towards the gangrene. So again, there is some collateral circulation, but overall it's just a single vessel. So again, this patient needed a surgery, needed a bypass, and after the bypass, you do the TCOMS and you see that oxygen numbers are getting better. And there is a good response to 100% oxygen. So again, this is something that you can do to monitor what's going on. There's a new thing that's out there, which is again, still not data proven, but something which is out there, something where we are able to take a picture of the wound and able to look at the foot and look at their oxygenation and deoxygenation by taking a picture. It takes less than 30 seconds. It's called a near infrared spectroscopy. And this is someone whom we did that on, someone who had an open diabetic TMA and foot wound. And we did this just before hyperbarics. And this, the color difference is what you're seeing between oxygenated and deoxygenated tissue. And as you see, just after 3 hours of hyperbarics, there is an tremendous response of oxygenation down there. And there's some data down there, but it's still not something which is routinely being used, but something that you may want to be thinking about. This is the protocol that we have developed for using PCPO2s and deciding which patients are the best for hyperbaric oxygen therapy. And that's what we have done here based on the data that we have so far. These are the numbers we are looking at. And if they have hypoxia, you want to get a vascular eval first. And this is an 100% oxygen challenge. And we want to see if they at least go up to 50 or 40, then we can do hyperbaric therapy adjunct. And we found that if you do an oxygen study inside the chamber, and if their oxygen goes above 400 inside the chamber, then they have a pretty good chance of that patients to do well with hyperbaric oxygen therapy. If they're between 200 and 400, then you want to try hyperbaric, but they have fair prognosis. But if their number is less than 200, then you want to just give a trial of 10 and then repeat the intra-chamber study because hyperbaric oxygen therapy may not work. Again, if you do revascularization, the data shows that there you can prolong life, which is a good data that you want to be looking at. That, you know, after angioplasty or after bypass graft, if you compare with someone who did not have any revascularization, as you see, their mortality is much higher on patient who did not have revascularization. But if the patient had bypass, if the patient had angioplasty, you can prolong life, which is a good data that you want to look at. And the data also shows that microvascular complication along with peripheral vascular disease directly associated with amputation. So as you see, that patients who have just macrovascular disease compared to someone who has both, they have a much higher risk. Microvascular is a small vessel disease, which is very common in patients with diabetes. So you're looking at patients who will have major vessel disease, which you can correct with angioplasty or a bypass, or someone also have a small vessel disease, which is really responsible to get a perfusion of the skin and helping these patients when they get amputations, whether it's going to heal or not. And that's where they show that if they are both, they have a much higher chance of amputation. But the good, another important study that I want you to look at is if you really even do a bypass or even if you do an angioplasty, a lot of these patients, this is a data after someone who got, patients who got inguinal bypass surgery for critical leg ischemia. And they found that they still have trouble healing. Like 40% of complete tissue healing by 6 months after bypass, 75% by 12 months, 25% never heal. And the median time to heal was almost 190 days. And amputation-free survival with complete healing was attained only on 50% of the patient at 1 year. So diabetes is significant, is a significant risk factor for delayed healing even after bypass. And a small vessel disease really is also causing problem even after bypass to heal this wound. It takes long time to heal, and sometimes even after bypass, this patient gets amputation. So there is a window of opportunity for doing a good wound care and doing hyperbaric oxygen therapy on some selected cases to help these patients from not getting amputation. Like Mr. RG, we were able to debride the wound. We were able to use our principles, the basic tenets of wound management, of diabetes control, offloading, and getting negative pressure therapy, getting good moist dressing, and hyperbaric oxygen therapy to get that wound to granulate. And because that patient also had osteomyelitis, patient was continued on IV antibiotics for 6 weeks. The bone culture had grown MRSA and strep, so it required IV antibiotics. Patient was continued on VANC and Zosyn for 6 weeks. With hyperbaric oxygen therapy, with negative pressure therapy, wound continued to get better, and we were able to close that wound with skin graft and get that wound to epithelialize. So this was a bioengineered skin that we used, but you could have used skin graft and get that wound to heal. So let's look at the data on hyperbaric oxygen therapy. I know a lot of people argue about hyperbaric oxygen therapy, if there is enough data to support. And let's look at the data because it's been studied for long. And hyperbaric oxygen therapy being, it's not a kind of a pharmaceutical drug. It does not get sponsorship to do a lot of clinical studies. So most of the studies this is done is by most of the hyperbarists who put their own money. So if you look at 1979, Hart and Strauss, 35 patients, 73% improved, 18% healed. Between 1979 and 1992, there is at least 10 retrospective or non-randomized trials with positive results. In 1992, the doctor did the first randomized control trial, and he found pretty good results. He put 15 in hyperbaric arm, 15 in control, and he found that the patient with hyperbaric arm, their statistically significant decrease in amputation compared to patients who were not on hyperbaric arm. So 2 out of 15 in hyperbaric and 7 out of 15 in control. Since then, the interest in diabetic foot ulcer continued to increase. From 1992 to 2017, there are 9 randomized control, and 7 of them 9 showed fewer major amputation using adjunctive hyperbaric oxygen therapy. And 2 of the 9 are negative studies. The recent data, though, had a negative data like Federico, but the Federico data has been challenged just because the data was done based on a clinical picture. The amputation decision was based on not clinical exam, but on clinical picture. And Santima data was negative study, but when we dissected the data, we found that the patients who finished 30 hyperbaric oxygen therapy treatments, those patients did well. So we feel that hyperbaric oxygen therapy is a drug, and you want to make sure that they finish their allotted treatment to get the best outcome. But all these studies had some flaws. None of them had a same hyperbaric protocol. None of them used the same standard wound care protocol. So that's why, we are still looking for more data with hyperbaric oxygen therapy. This is the most recent retrospective data that just came out in 2019. And if they looked at more than 300,000 patients, and they found that patients who were on hyperbaric arm did better than patients who were not on hyperbaric arm. They did much better, and they had fewer amputation, and this is for Wagner grade 3 and Wagner grade 4. But even here, in this 300,000 records, when they looked at patients who completed 30 hyperbaric oxygen therapy, those patients did much better and had a much better healing rates and decreased amputation compared to patients who did not finish 30 hyperbaric oxygen therapy. So compliance, compliant patient who finished their dose of hyperbaric oxygen therapy did better than patient who did not. So again, this is a good data that we want to look at. So basically, what our professional society recommends at this point is Wagner grade 2, there is really not much evidence for hyperbaric oxygen therapy, but for Wagner grade 3 and higher, using hyperbaric oxygen therapy as adjunctive treatment as with standard wound management is a good thing to do. Literature predominantly supports use of hyperbaric oxygen therapy for diabetic foot ulcers, except for last two papers published by Diabetes Care. The Strenous Grade Review of Published Literature in 2015 by Enoch et al. Supports hyperbaric use in Wagner grade 3 and grade 4 diabetic foot ulcers. And again, the last strenuous grade review was done in 2017 by Ontario Technology Assessment, and it shows benefit in wound healing, but questionable in decreasing amputation. So when we looked at starting HBO therapy immediately, it does decrease major amputation and improve healing rates. But again, it's not approved by CMS, and most of the insurance company does not approve that at this point. Again, the question is the economic value of HBO therapy is being questioned in current climate of value-based wound care. But if you really look at the cost of amputation, and if you really look at the mortality data, the cost can be easily justified in the severe diabetic foot ulcer patients with diabetic foot ulcer with hyperbaric oxygen therapy. The more important is about prevention and decreasing recurrence of diabetic foot ulcer patients, because once this patient has neuropathy, once they have foot deformity, and once they get diabetic foot ulcer, even after you heal these patients have higher risk of getting that ulcer coming back. So again, if you really look at this New England Journal of Medicine data, and they looked at what are the risk factor which are independently associated with ulcer reoccurrence, and they found that the three most important ones were vibration perception threshold greater than 25, presence of pre-ulcerative lesion, or presence of peripheral arterial disease. These three really were the most important ones that you want to look for. And so if they have a neuropathy, if they have a peripheral arterial disease, and they have a pre-ulcerative lesion, then they have a highest chance of reoccurrence. So this patient needs to be monitored closely and has to be taken care of in a way that this patient will not get reoccurrence. So when Dr. Armstrong also looked at in the same study to which are the main things that you can do to help you to prevent foot reoccurrence, the number one thing was integrated foot care, making sure this patient is being seen by a podiatrist or by primary care physician who is going to do the foot care, because you know primary care doctors should be able to do good foot care, doesn't have to be referred all the time. They should be able to help patients with self-management of diabetes. Patients' education was very important to prevent the reoccurrence. Using therapeutic footwear was extremely important that primary care physician needs to be familiar with and make sure that that patient has a good therapeutic footwear. And in some studies, they share if the patient got foot surgery, if they have a foot deformity and they were able to get the correction of the foot deformity surgery, then that patient's could also decrease the reoccurrence. But again, you want to only use this in a patient who are younger, has a good peripheral circulation, where foot deformity surgery will have the least chance of having trouble. So those are the ones where you can do prophylactic foot deformity surgery to decrease reoccurrence. Again, very important to understand that to save limbs and to decrease amputation in diabetic foot ulcer, you need to work as a team. You know, you can't work in silos, because multidisciplinary teams reduces amputation. And it's important that we all work together. And a lot of data shows that when we work together, when our primary care doctor, vascular surgeon, infectious doctor, wound doctor, podiatrist, or a surgeon works together, you can save limbs. If we work in silos, you will not save the limb. All the data support and favors multidisciplinary team. So if you don't have a limb salvage team, if you don't have a multidisciplinary team, please have it, because that's the only way you can decrease amputation. Everybody working together with a singular goal of decreasing amputation will help your patients. There is an epidemic of diabetes. In summary, I'd like to say that there is really epidemic of diabetes, diabetic foot ulcer, and amputation in South Texas. We need to really work as team. We need to get multidisciplinary team. Everybody needs to get involved, because diabetic foot ulcer has a higher mortality than a breast cancer, prostate cancer, or lymphoma combined. Standardized evaluation of diabetic foot ulcer and a coordinated care can improve outcomes. And hyperbaric oxygen therapy has overall good evidence as an adjunct treatment for Wegener grade 3 and 4 diabetic foot ulcer. Thank you so much. I will be available for questions. These are some of my references, the books that I've written. There is an app, which is a free app, a wound doctor app, which you could download, and that will help you select dressing or some of the protocols that I have been discussing. And that's another textbook that recently came out, 2018, that is another reference for you to look at. And I'm available for questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shaw. If anybody has any questions, please feel free to unmute yourself or to type it in the chat box there. Okay, well, in the absence of questions, if anybody thinks of anything, please email me and I will send that off to Dr. Shaw. And if you could, please remember to complete the evaluation for him today so that we can give him some feedback. And we just want to thank you, Dr. Shaw, for your presentation today. We really appreciate you visiting with us and going over these management tips.
Thank you so much.
Everybody have a good day.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Mm-hmm.